Good afternoon and welcome to our media briefing. As many of you know, yesterday we had a Board of Supervisors meeting and we took a number of actions in regards to this COVID crisis that we've been dealing with. I'm going to go over some of the things that we did yesterday at the board meeting and then we'll move on to the update of the cases and the data. Yesterday, a majority of the Board of Supervisors agreed to send this letter to Governor Newsom, which requests more local control so we can move further into our recovery. Because of our positive data results and the good job San Diegans have been doing to slow the spread of the virus, we believe there are several stage three activities that could be opened and managed and worth taking a look at. These include youth sports, fitness facilities, pools, sports fishing, tour boats, indoor museums, hotels, wineries and breweries, and theme parks. We also believe religious facilities could be opened more broadly beyond the 25% or 100-person cap the state has imposed, provided that we have another week of positive data. Each business sector would have to abide by reopening protocols showing how they will adhere to the strict safety guidelines. Before opening, our public health officer would review the protocols in detail with each sector before giving a final reopening approval. We feel we are ready to move to this new stage because several weeks have passed since we accelerated openings within stage two, and the data shows that these openings have occurred without any significant impact to our healthcare system. In fact, every indicator has been stable or in some cases improved. 13 triggers have been identified, including mandatory measures identified by state health department as well as data requests from our local hospital system leaders. I want to emphasize, however, that if we move forward, it won't be like flicking the light switch. As the governor has said many times, it's more like turning a dimmer where we actually open up more business activities. Let me touch on another item that we took action on yesterday, and that was to expand our moratorium on evictions of residential and commercial tenants and renters in our unincorporated area. That moratorium expired on Sunday, and so we extended it through the end of June. We know there are many folks who are still out there that are out of work and suffering. This moratorium is intended to give them a little breathing room. It doesn't wipe away their rents. It just prevents families from being forced out on the streets. Now we know landlords have obligations to meet, and so our moratorium asks that renters pay as much rent as possible and to set up payment plans with their landlords where feasible. Every little step that we take to help people get through this rough times makes a big difference. I'm proud to propose this action along with Supervisor Fletcher, which gives a good transition to introduce him at this time. He's going to talk about these important triggers that we are following to avoid sliding back in our efforts to stop the spread of COVID-19. So let me welcome Supervisor Fletcher.
Thank you, Chairman Coxton. Good afternoon. While we know there is considerable focus and energy in our community on the protest and the situation surrounding the unfortunate loss of life of Mr. Floyd and broader societal issues, our work around coronavirus continues and our work to coordinate our effective response, monitor our reopening and continue to move forward is ongoing. We also know that there is a number of things that continue to be in flux surrounding this, and so I just want to provide a quick clarification on the relationship between the state and the county at this point. Governor Gavin Newsom has announced that there will be local control of stage three entities once the state of California provides what they call the how. He said the state will outline the how these additional entities can open by releasing guidance, industry-specific guidance. Once they release that guidance, then it will be up to county public health officers to determine the when. As it stands right now, we have not received any additional guidance since they made that announcement. Once they put out additional guidance for an entity, then Dr. Wilma Wooten will review it, and we'll determine when is the appropriate point for San Diego County to move forward into that phase. And so we will certainly keep you posted, not only on anything we hear from the state about what has been released, but also with Dr. Wooten's assessment of that guidance, along with putting the appropriate opening time or date here in San Diego County. In addition to continuing to look at opportunities for reopening, I want to share with you today, and Dr. Wooten's going to cover it as well, our triggers, our modified triggers that are guiding our reopening process. We've said from the beginning of this that our actions would be guided based on the data and based on the science. We have a number of things we've been sharing with you from the very beginning. We continue to adapt and evolve as we get clearer indications of the best way to measure the impact of coronavirus. And so today we want to walk you through the triggers as it relates to monitoring our ability to reopen. Our hope is and continues to be that none of these triggers are ever hit, and that we can continue a gradual and smooth, safe, responsible reopening. But as we've also said from the beginning, it's important that we monitor the situation in real time and assess. Before I get into them, I will tell you that presently we are green. We are in a good position on all 13 of the metrics, all 13 of the measurements that are in our system. And we hope that that continues, and that's why we ask the public's continued help. The issues around physical distancing, face covering, hand washing, temperature check, screening, following the safe reopening protocols, following the guidance, all of us doing as much as we possibly can are things that will help us ensure that we stay in a green position and we can continue to move forward with phased reopening. The second thing I'll share with you before I get into it, and you will see it in a minute, is it's a little complex. It's a little nuanced. We have tried to design what we think best reflects the conditions on the ground and best reflects our desire to continue to stay open while being mindful of the public health dangers. And so there's a series of steps and triggers. And so I'm going to do my best to walk you through it. We may have to come back and do it again, but we certainly want to be very transparent. Dr. Wooten walked through this presentation at our Board of Supervisors meeting yesterday, but we wanted to share it with you again today in order to let you know what we are monitoring and tracking on a daily basis and what will dictate and determine our ability to continue to move forward and what things it is that might cause us to take some alternate actions. So we'll start with the first slide here. What you see here is the 13 triggers for modifying the public health officer's order. And you can see them in three different categories. You have them in epidemiology and surveillance. Second category in healthcare, that's basically hospital capacity. The third category there is in public health and the response. And then in each of those, you see the 13 triggers broken up into those three categories. Now, what is important to note is what would cause us to take some type of action. There are two different ways that we would be required to rethink what we're doing or reassess our ability to continue to move forward. We'll go to the next slide here. The first is if any of these three criteria are met, if any of these triggers are triggered, then we would immediately take some remedial action as it relates to our ability to move forward. Any one of these three are triggered, then we would take action. The first is community outbreaks. That's no more than 7 new outbreaks in a community setting in a 7-day period. Now, it is important to note that a community outbreak is not a congregate care setting or a skilled nursing facility. It's not a healthcare entity, it is a true community outbreak out in the community. So if we saw more than 7 new outbreaks in a 7-day period, that would immediately trigger that stage. The second one would be limited intensive care ICU capacity. We report this to you daily in terms of how we're doing as a region on our ICU capacity. If we were ever under 20% availability of ICU beds, that by itself would also trigger action. The third is around personal protective equipment. If only 50% of the hospitals have at least a 15-day supply of PPE over a rolling 13-day period, that would trigger. To be clear on this, it is any of these three criteria. Any one of these three would cause us to take action. What would those actions be? We'll go to the next. It depends on the action. It depends on a number of circumstances around what caused us to hit that trigger, but we have a range of options at the public health officer's discretion. The first would be industry-specific action. This could be an individual company might be closed because perhaps there's something, a significant outbreak or something that's happening there that's causing problems. It could be a industry-wide, a certain segment, if there's clear and compelling evidence that a certain segment is causing problems, it could be that segment. It could be things tied to our healthcare industry. Maybe we dial back elective procedures or we do some other type of action, surge capacity, but it would be industry-specific actions that could run a wide range or gamut of options. The second thing, if we hit a trigger, could be simply pausing. Go back. Could be simply pausing, which just means we're going to stop where we are. We're not going to open up anything additional. We're going to pause. We're going to monitor the impact on the metrics, and we're going to continue to evaluate where we are. And then the third and more drastic step would be countywide dial backs of entire steps that we've taken positive. Now, again, we don't want any of these things to happen, which is why we continue to move cautiously. We continue to move methodically. We continue to move slowly. But if any one of those three triggers I mentioned were hit, then these are the range of options that we could take under the public health officer's discretion in terms of addressing that. Now, there is a second way that we could also be forced to take action. Let's go to the next slide. This slide, again, has all of the original 13, and we highlighted for you on a previous slide, in a previous effort, we focused in on the three that by themselves would cause us to move backwards. Those three are number 2, number 7, and number 9. But in addition to any one of those, with the remaining ones here, if we ever hit a situation where one or more of the triggers in 2 of the 3 columns are met. So what that means is if you look at what is left there, you see 2, 7, and 9 are in a different color because those are standalone triggers by themselves. But let's say those three are still in a green position and they're good. We have not hit those triggers. If one or more of the remaining criteria in 2 of the 3 columns are met, then that would also cause us to take action. The actions that we would take for this triggering effect would be exactly the same as the others. So again, I know that it is a little bit confusing, and we will certainly walk through this multiple times, but at its core, if you look at trigger items 2, 7, and 9, if those are hit, that by itself is enough for us to have to take action. And I walk through the range of actions. If those three are green, we have not hit those, then if one or more of what is left in 2 of the 3 columns are met, that would also cause us to take action. We are trying to design a system that really takes into account a realistic condition of what's on the ground. We also don't want to have a situation that causes us to too quickly or too swiftly trigger and have to take action. And so although I know it comes across as a little complicated, it is based on a series of best practices, evaluations of other jurisdictions, consultations with healthcare leaders from a number of places, and trying to give us the best and clearest sense of our progress as it relates to a region. And Dr. Wooten's going to walk through where we are on these, and then we'll be modifying our presentations to be more aligned with regularly providing you the updates on where we are on these 13 triggers. So with that, let's jump into our daily update, our charts today. The first here, we have a new record for number of tests today, 4,940. We had a little batch come in from one hospital system, but we are hopeful that we continue to move upwards. But we're significantly over today, our 7-day rolling average. We've had some challenges with the state testing system reporting back. Those tests are still being conducted. There's a little bit of lag in getting those back. But again, we want to get over that 5,000 number. We want to stay over that 5,000 number and continue to advance forward. Contact tracing continues to increase. We're now over 400 on the way to our initial goal of 450 at 408. And so that continues to work well. And then our public health motel rooms remain available for those in need of isolation treatment. In terms of our cases today, we're reporting 124 new positive tests, again, out of that 4,940 total tests for a 3% average, just barely de minimisly above our 14-day rolling average. Our 14-day rolling average is 2.9. Yesterday we were 3, today we're 3. Previous days we were 2. So again, this remains flat, which is encouraging. Next, we'll look at our hospital daily census in San Diego County. You can see ICUs down a little bit from yesterday. a little higher than the day before, but again, holding considerably flat along the line there over the preceding 30 days. Total COVID-related hospitalizations down a little bit yesterday from today, up a few from last week, but again, holding relatively flat. And then next, we will look at the, again, you have the COVID-related ICU census. This is our ICU hospitalizations. COVID ICU utilization at 158, non-COVID there at 294, and again, the ICU bed capacity at 64. Again, one of the immediate triggers we talked about earlier was if that ICU bed capacity, if the availability, if the ICU bed occupied were to go above 80%, that would be one of the triggers. So again, we are doing well in regards to that metric. That concludes my section of the report. I will now turn it over to Dr. Wilma Wooten for a public health officer's report.
Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you, Supervisor Fletcher. Based on COVID-19 data from the Johns Hopkins dashboard that was obtained approximately 12 noon today, the global, national, and state statistics are as follows. Globally, there are almost 6.5 million positive cases, including over 382,000 deaths. Nationwide, the United States is reporting over 1,840,000 positive cases, now at 29% of the global number, and includes over 107,000 deaths. Statewide, California is reporting over 117,500 positive cases, including 4,320 deaths. And today, the County of San Diego is reporting 7,798 cases, which is 120 more cases than yesterday and includes 283 deaths, which is 7 more deaths reported since yesterday. So as an aside, in the next slide, I just wanted to show the weekly average on the left side of the screen and the daily averages for the past several days. And in general, we have an average of about 110 new cases daily. So our numbers since May 16th, the highest number was on the 20th at 175 new cases. In the past several weeks, in the past 5 weeks, the numbers are lower, but there is not a consistent or a steep downward trend. So as we are testing, and we expect that more tests will occur, or rather more positive cases will occur as we reach our goal of approximately 5,000. And once we move into stage three, the state's stage three, the expectation is that we will test 2 tests per 1,000 individuals on a daily basis. So that will go up to about 6,600 tests per day. So moving on, the average age of our total number of cases is from 3 months to 102 years of age. The median age is in the mid-40s. 4,090 cases are in the age group of 20 to 49 years of age, and this comprises 52% of all of the cases. Gender remains to be split 50% between male and female. There's 1,362, or 18%, of cases hospitalized, and of this number, 392 have been admitted to the ICU. This is 5% of the total number of cases and 29% of the total number of cases hospitalized. Talking about deaths, we have 283 deaths reported, which is approximately 4% of the total number of cases. And today we are reporting 7 additional deaths since yesterday. The dates of these deaths occurred between May 28th and June 2nd. The age range is from 62 to 91 years of age. 42% were female, 58% were male. 271 had underlying medical conditions, which represents 96% of the total number of deaths. 11 of the total had no underlying medical conditions, which is 4% of the total number of deaths. And one is pending confirmation. Regarding the race and ethnicity for all deaths, we have data for 99% or 278 of the 283 total number of deaths, which means we do not have a race and ethnicity for four. Of this total for which we have data, 121 or 43% were white, 119 or 43% also were Latino or Hispanic, 27 or 10% are Asian, 8 or 3% are Black or African American, 2 or 0.7% are Pacific Islanders, and we have one each, which is 0.4% American Indian, and an individual of multiple races. And as usual, the county extends its sincerest sympathies and condolences to the family and friends of those individuals who have been lost to COVID-19 reported here today. So all of our statistics, as usual, can be found on the county's website, which is on the sign in front of us and at the bottom of the slides that we are projecting. In regards to reported outbreaks in skilled nursing facilities, non-skilled nursing facility, congregate settings, and community settings, today we are reporting that 55 confirmed, or rather, not 55 confirmed active outbreaks. We also had 37 prior outbreaks that have been determined to be inactive, as there have been no cases in the past 14 days or longer. These included 6 skilled nursing facilities, 14 non-skilled nursing facility congregate settings, and 17 community settings. Currently, as stated, there are 55 active outbreaks. 20 of the 55 active outbreaks are in the county's 86 skilled nursing facilities, and we've had one new outbreak reported since yesterday. This group has generated 796 cases, which includes 78 deaths. 23 of the 55 outbreaks are in non-skilled nursing facility congregate settings. We also have had one new outbreak reported since yesterday, with a total number of cases in this group at 802, which includes 60 deaths. And lastly, we have 12 of the 55 active outbreaks in community settings, with 2 new outbreaks reported since yesterday, and this includes 355 cases and 5 deaths. Now, in the next slide, talking about the triggers, Supervisor Fletcher has gone over those, but I would just like to share how we will progress with these going forward. And this is the slide that was shown at the Board of Supervisors meeting yesterday. The 13 criteria, again, have been developed across 3 categories that include epidemiology or surveillance, healthcare or hospital capacity, and public health or response. The health officer's order will be modified when any one of the following 3 criteria are met. This includes community outbreaks or PPE supply or ICU capacity. So if any one of those 3 metrics dips into the red and goes beyond being green, that is a trigger, and action will be taken. Another scenario could be when one or more of the remaining criteria in at least 2 of the 3 columns also are met. And Supervisor Fletcher gave a great example and depiction of that. These criteria will be continuously assessed and modified as needed and as new information becomes available to us. Today, the county is launching its dashboard for these 13 triggers. And I might also count that we have the 3 categories. For each of the 13 triggers, the first part of that, like case count, that's actually the criteria, and then the actual trigger is the additional text. So this dashboard will be updated periodically, with a couple of exceptions, based on when the data is available. We hope to try to update it on a daily basis, but in some cases it might be every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, and in some cases weekly. Again, this depends upon the availability of the data. The dashboard measures the county's performance data pertaining to the 13 criteria. And green indicates that we are trending in the right direction, and as you see here, and as Supervisor Fletcher noted earlier, all of the triggers now are green. So this is very good news. So this will be posted today at the on our website at the end of the day. Going forward, probably beginning next week, what we will have is that users that go to the website can click on any one of the criteria and get a pop-up of the slide that we showed at the Board of Supervisors meeting on yesterday. For today, we will have the summary of the triggers as well as this snapshot to show where we are with each of the 13 triggers. So remember, practicing good hand hygiene and environmental sanitation, maintaining physical distance when you come in contact with individuals outside of your household, and using face covering and conducting screenings where practical are all great public health, all of great public health importance, but are only as useful as they are implemented and practiced. So we will continue to request your support and patience, and we'll continue to monitor aggressively these triggers that we've shared with you today. Now please welcome back to the podium Chairman Cox. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Wooten. We'll go directly to the questions.
John Carroll with KPBS, please state your question.
Hi, this question is for Dr. Wooten. Doctor, as Chairman Cox referenced earlier in this news conference, the Board of Supervisors voted to send that letter to allow us to have more local control and be able to move further into stage three. Do you support that kind of a move that's detailed in that letter? And I may have a follow-up.
Thank you for that question, and yes, we are in support of the letter that's being sent to the state. We recognize that our community is hurting in terms of businesses being closed. Our metrics support the fact that we can open, and as we have not received guidance, but we are submitting this letter. The Board of Supervisors are submitting this letter, just as we submitted the pilot program. And thankfully, some of those items on the pilot program were implemented. So as this information is sent to the governor, we hope that other industries will also open up.
Thank you very much.
Okay, let's go to the next question.
Okay, Taryn Mento with KPBS, please state your question.
Hi, thank you. Yeah, at the board meeting yesterday, it was discussed that there may be a spike in COVID cases because of recent demonstrations. And in Minnesota, the state health department is suggesting people who participated in protests there get tested in about 5 to 7 days, regardless if they have symptoms. Does the county also recommend that here? And if so, does our current testing guidelines and resources allow for that? If you can address both the guidelines and resources.
Okay, I will ask Dr. Wooten to respond.
So when you are exposed, so the assumption might be that there would be people that are in the civil unrest that might be potentially infectious. And as people are exposed to them, they may be also become infected. We do not have that same recommendation at this point in time. We are aggressively monitoring cases and inquiring about their activities. If an individual or a case is identified and positive. So at this time, we are not doing the same thing as Minneapolis is doing, but we are aggressively monitoring new cases over the next 14 days. And that's not only for the riots, but we're doing that for the industries that are opening up, asking people about if they've attended worship services or any restaurants. And if we see any patterns, then we can go back and interview individuals. So that's our strategy at this time.
And as a follow-up, the protests against stay-home orders last month, did we see any sort of spike or increase related to those gatherings?
I am not aware. We are not aware of any specific outbreaks or spikes in the number of cases as it relates to those particular outbreaks. Oh, I'm sorry, as those particular riots or peaceful marches.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay, let's go to our last call-in question.
Okay. Will Huntsberry with Voice of San Diego, please state your question.
Hey there, everyone. I was lucky enough to listen to the presentation yesterday, today, about the 13 triggers. So I think I mostly get it. It obviously gets a little complicated with the if one trigger in at least two categories are set off, then action could be taken. What I was wondering is, you know, does that mean that if all four triggers in the public health or in the response category, if all those went off, no action would be taken? Or if regular hospital capacity, regular hospital bed capacity got over 80%, but nothing else happened, no action would be taken. You know, the same for COVID syndromic cases showing up. Can you address that?
Okay, Dr. Wooten's going to respond.
Well, thank you again for your question. So the first criteria, the first trigger, one of those three. So one of the three includes includes PPE, it includes community outbreaks, and community outbreaks is very important. You've heard what our outbreaks have been today. So when we get an increase and have at least in 1 week period of time, seven community outbreaks, and even before we get to seven, that will be cause for pause and to assess where these outbreaks are occurring or if there's any association between these various outbreaks. Or if there's PPE supply that is below, is 50% or below, that singular criteria is cause for us to take action. And again, ICU capacity, which is very important and tied to hospitalization. Then what you're asking, if there is one, or rather one or more in any of the three categories, of the remaining categories or criteria. So that would be the next round. So if you can show that again, and I think the one that Supervisor Fletcher had, but if you can just show the summary of the triggers. So these are the three, this one right here. So if number two, number nine, and also intensive care unit, which is number seven. So if those, any one, is not together, either one individually could cause a chain reaction for us to look at what's going on and dial back. But outside of those three, if we have one or more in two of the three columns, so one in epidemiology or one in public health, and not or, and one in public health, or one in healthcare and one in public health, that also would cause us to look at what's going on and then help us determine if we need to dial back. And as explained by Supervisor Fletcher, For instance, if it's outbreaks, and if all of the outbreaks are in restaurants, we will look at those restaurants, not impact the entire restaurant industry. So the situation, it depends on what the situation is, what the metric is, and then we would delve into that data even further and decide what our actions would be. Does that help you understand the process further?
Well, I actually had, yes, I understand those things. I appreciate that that explanation. So I had a question that kind of goes one level deeper.
Okay.
You know, what if only number five hospital capacity approaches 80%? What if only number five gets set off? I mean, that's a pretty scary metric. But if only that one gets set off and nothing else, the public health department can't take any action yet. Is that correct?
Well, we would look at all of the metrics, Will. I mean, nothing is in isolation. I'm trying to bring up the summary. Could you please bring up this summary? So number five is hospital capacity. Certainly, if we are approaching, and we wouldn't wait until hospital capacity reaches, if everything reaches 80%, we would start to look at that well before that. Right now, we have 35% capacity available, and we've been at about 65%, thank you, we've been about at 65% consistently of hospital in capacity being utilized. If we started going up to 70 or 75%, we would be concerned and would start talking with our healthcare systems to take action. So we would be looking at all of these individually, but those are just some triggers that we wanted to provide to the public that could give you a sense of what actions we would take if those triggers were met. I mean, keep in mind, we have not, this has never happened before. So every time we see changes in the metrics, that will necessitate potentially a change in our modifying our targets as well. Does that help help you understand more?
I think I have it now, yes.
Okay.
So it sounds like it would be safe to say, you know, it's within your jurisdiction as the public health officer or in your department's jurisdiction to, you know, if one thing is really concerning, you could still take action.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Got it.
Okay.
Thank you so much, Dr.
Thank
Whitney.
You. You're welcome.
Row for you. The first one is a bit of a narrative from Nelly Cervantes from El Imparcial, Tijuana. So I'll read the narrative and then she has a couple of follow-up questions. People in San Diego fear that Tijuana residents are bringing COVID to South Bay hospitals on the other side. People in Tijuana believe it is California residents who introduced coronavirus to the Mexican side because they keep visiting family members in Baja despite the stay-at-home orders on this side. I would like to hear the perspective of the doctors on both assumptions based on the data they've seen since the start of this pandemic.
Well, first of all, we have U.S. citizens and legal residents that live in Mexico but are U.S. citizens of the United States. So most of the people that actually the individuals that are being admitted, if they come from Mexico, are U.S. citizens and residents and have the right to utilize our healthcare system. That's number one. There's not a horde of individuals that are not residents coming from Mexico being admitted to our hospitals here in San Diego. So if that is the perception that individuals have, that is the wrong perception, number one. We have a global society. People are global, moving back and forth across the border. People have family in Mexico. People live in Mexico, have family in the United States. So disease travels, and the borders has no respect for disease. So you know or recognize that the border has been closed to individuals except for those essential workers and American citizens or legal residents. And those are the individuals that are currently crossing back and forward across the border.
And she was kind of following up with, do you have any updates on any cross-border spreading?
We know how many individuals, say for instance, of our cases live in Mexico. We have close relationships with the Mexican government, and they share with us what's going on their side of the border. Last week, a presentation was provided and showed that Tijuana probably peaked at about the same time that we did, as well as Mexicali last week was going through its potential peak. Things seem to have quieted down. There's always going to be movement back and forward across the border, but we will continually closely monitor that. And has been stated previously, there is a task force that looks at border activity that is composed of over 20 different federal, state, and local agencies, including our county, including EMS, Border Protections, the Port Authority, the City of San Diego, and looking at transports, looking at hospitalizations, and also looking at border crossings. So all of those, this issue is being closely monitored by a lot of people.
Thank you for that. I have a question from Julia News, and it's regarding a waiver. Could a small back county community get a waiver from restrictions on group activities? We've only had 2 reported COVID cases.
We are not issuing any waivers, no.
And this question is from Mike McKinnon with KUSI News. Dr. Wooten recently said the stay-at-home orders saved thousands of lives. Now that thousands of people are disobeying those orders with protests across the county, how many new coronavirus cases and or deaths do you expect as a result of these large gatherings?
I can't begin to predict what will occur, except that there is the potential for new cases to occur if there are infected individuals involved in the civil unrest and other individuals are infected. And actually what we've said, and it is not just what I've said, it's what the data has proven based on the modeling conducted by Dr. Natasha Martin, and then Johns Hopkins also did similar modeling, and they were both the results were both very close, anywhere from 12 to 15,000 deaths were potentially prevented as a result of the non-pharmaceutical interventions that were implemented by San Diego.
Thank you. And this question is from Paul Sisson. Has the county detected any cases related to exposures in locations recently reopened, such as beaches, restaurants, casinos, barbershops, or salons?
Well, in terms of the restaurants, they have not been open 14 days yet. So in a short, Paul, no, but we are closely monitoring. As stated, we ask questions as new cases are now occurring so that we can potentially pinpoint if there is a particular industry that is associated with the new cases.
And this last question is from Taryn Mento with KPBS, a follow-up to her call. As I understand it, the board also voted in favor of opening all beach parking lots and allowing all activities at beaches. When does Dr. Wooten expect to approve those steps that the board recommended?
So it is not within my authority. It's within the authority of the cities, and as has been stated by Supervisor Fletcher before, we coordinated this effort with the cities, the coastal cities. And so we are working collaboratively with the coastal cities and to open up, and it's based on when they want to do that. Thank you.
Well, that concludes our questions for today. We will not be holding a media briefing tomorrow, but our communication staff will send out a daily update. And for ongoing updates, again, we encourage you to please get on the coronavirus website at coronavirus-sd.com. That's it for today. Please stay safe, San Diego, and we'll see you on Friday.